see all of you and that all of you are here. And this, on this most beautiful day outside, and it is the day that the Lord has made. So let us rejoice and be glad in it. Announcements? Are there any announcements to share with everybody today?
I do.
Okay, somebody.
I hear the voice nobody can hear. The second hymn is new to me. I never saw it. I think it was written on another planet, but it's fine. So I thought when we do the second hymn, page 27, I'll play it through with one finger melody only. I guarantee it won't help you. Okay, it won't help. But anyway, we'll get through it and it'll be fine and we'll be done. That's all.
I'm embarrassed. Okay. Apparently I chose something that you are not familiar with. Well, just as Wally said, but if it becomes too much of a hassle, just relax, listen to Wally play, and we'll go along right from there. All right. Anything else? Well, of course, we turn now to our most important part of our ministries and things here, and that's our prayer concerns. We want to make sure that we keep everybody in our prayers. Yes?
A new prayer for Judy Edith. Her cancer has returned. So prayers for Judy Edith.
Okay, well, Lord, we lift Judy up to you, and we put her into your hands, and we hope that everything can go well with her, and that there is healing. And we humbly ask for healing for her, and we just put it all into your hands, Lord. Thank you. Amen.
I have a praise report. My friend Kathy, that you've been praying for weeks and weeks and weeks. All of her tests have come back normal. She is feeling excellent. She's home, and thanks everyone for all of the prayers.
Well, we certainly praise God for that. Yes, we give you praise, oh God, for all of this and all of this healing. And it's been a tough trip and a journey, but you are always there with us, and we know that we can depend on you, and we give you all praise and thanks for this wonderful, wonderful news. And we lift that all up to you, Lord. Amen. Okay, well, be sure to look over your bulletins and note all of those things that are going on into the life of the church. Be a part of all of that if you can. Your prayer to help out anywhere that you might be able. Let us turn to God and pray. Holy One, we come to you today full of hope, full of desire, full of promise. Help us to take up the mantle of faith that you have laid before us, that we may use our own gifts of spirit to face the challenges before us. Help us face the turmoil within and around us, that we may face the future unafraid. Show us your way, your truth, and your life. Amen. Let us all stand and join together with the call of worship as it is found in your bulletin. Throughout the ages, disciples have said, I will follow you wherever you go. We come from busy homes filled with little time to consider Christ in our lives. In times of struggle, we look to God for help.
Lord, give us the opportunity to
celebrate the Holy Spirit who shows us the joy of following God.
Lord, give us the patience to follow you and the faith.
Amen.
The hymn is Lord Divine, All Loves Excelling. It's 92.
Bringing words of hope
and healing, your actions and compassion and justice.
Bring me our hesitant heart commandment to you and to the ministry of soul peace.
We want good things to happen. We just aren't sure that we are up to the best set for us. Forgive us when we so easily doubt your call, your presence, and your abiding love.
Lift us up from the lives of self-pity and self-centeredness,
and bring us to you, our hearts filled with joy. Praise you for the opportunity to witness to your love and our service to your people. Heal us and restore us, for we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Christ has set us free. Claim your forgiveness. Rejoice in God's grace. Respond with love. And you know that Christ has given us his commandments through God. You shall love your God with all of your heart and with all of your soul and with all of your mind. This is the first and the greatest of all of the commandments. But there is a second like it. You shall love your neighbor as you love yourself. On these two commandments depend all of the law and the prophet. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us turn back to our God in prayer. Holy God, your promises provide the path of hope for what seems impossible under the weight of our hopelessness. Still, when the world seems to be closing in on us, we pause to pray. We turn to you, speak to you in hope and the faith that you listen when your people pray. Time moves so fast. Life seems always ahead of us, urging us faster and faster. And may this moment of prayer unite us as a family of faith and as a body of Christ. Oh Lord, we often do not hear about the small wonders that are performed everywhere in your name as good people reach out to those in need. So take away our blindness and our doubt. Surround us with a strong faith that when we hear the words of healing, we may confidently know that you are in the midst of all of our lives. Heal our wounded spirits. Restore us in a spirit of joy. Now, as we have lifted the names of dear ones in our prayers before you, O God, we ask for your healing blessings on each of their lives and situations. And we also ask for your healing mercies on all areas in which there is strife, oppression, and despair. Comfort your people with your love. And we also have praise for you for the healing and the wonders that you have performed. But we pray for those whose lives have been turned upside down because of fires or floods and the effects of the pandemic, and the situation in the Ukraine. You love, you weep, you act, and we are grateful for your ear, Holy God, as we lift our prayers up to you, God, our Creator, our Redeemer, and Sustainer. Oh Lord, finally hear us as we pray the prayer that Christ has taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Now, like I said, if this hymn, I did not realize that this was something that you've never done. So if it becomes a little bit of an issue, sit, relax, listen to while they play. It'll be beautiful.
Thank you.
promise I will not do that to you again. But I have to say, that all the years that I've been doing this, only twice have I had to do something I couldn't know. So, I guess I've got a good record. Yes, five.
The words were beautiful, though, and the music was wonderful to listen to. Great. So, thank you for picking it out.
All right.
And waking us up.
All right. Well, I don't know. You can't with my beard, you can't see the blushing, but that's all right. All right, well, we're going to take our scripture from Paul's letter to the Galatians. And he's been traveling all around. He's been going all around. He's been doing church startups everywhere. And he gets to Galatia, and everything's going well until he leaves. And once he leaves, then and people were not called Christians, all right, in those days. Judaizers, there's a couple different names for the Jewish, what we call now Jewish Christians, all right? But these Pharisees, Judaizers, were going around and they decided they wanted to spread a little different gospel than what Jesus, or what Paul, through Jesus, had been spreading, telling. And they decided they got kind of off record a little bit, and well, there was idols and there was all kinds of things going on. So Paul, in this is part of the letter, and Paul's that we're going to read this morning is answering that. He's saying that let's skip back on track because this is not the gospel as Jesus was preaching it. So listen, as Jesus speaks, as God speaks through his living word. You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free. But do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love. For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command: love your neighbor as yourself. Now, if you fight and devour each other, watch out, and you will be destroyed by each other. So, I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with one another, so that you are not to do whatever you want. But if you are held by the Spirit, you are not under the law. The acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, adultery, and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dimensions, dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. Now I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. This is the word of the Lord. Those of you who were here, do you remember the last time I was here? I spoke about love always costs something. It always costs something. And, oh my gosh, I don't even know, a long, long time ago, I talked about more or less the very same thing. The spirit and the flesh. Now the flesh, every time you hear that word flesh, it means our sinful part, our urge for sin and doing whatever we want to whatever we want. Okay? Flesh. Flesh versus spirit. I did a whole sermon on that a long time ago. And I used it as they were teams. They were teams against each other. Spirit, flesh. Flesh, spirit. Fighting. They were fighting each other. And the winner of that battle, got your soul. So we have to be careful. So now we're at the point in our scriptures where Paul has now left the church in Galatia. And a group of converted Pharisees have started teaching a so-called gospel contrary to what Paul had taught. Paul taught that we, you know, the same thing that we're taught and what we believe today, and that is Jesus died for our sins. And we are no longer slaves to the law. But through the grace of God, we are forgiven. And when Paul founded the churches in Galatia, he taught and preached to them a gospel of justification by faith in Jesus Christ. We are justified. Made right, forgiven by our faith in Christ Jesus, which in turn leads us to live a life based on the way Jesus lived. Ethical, moral, sacrificial. But these Jewish Christians, or Judaizers, as they have come to be called, were telling the Gentiles that faith in Jesus was fine, but they needed to be circumcised. And they had to follow the Mosaic law. They insisted that no non-Jew could be saved without submitting to circumcision and observing the law of Moses. Remember that we're not talking just about the Ten Commandments, but of the 613 laws that make up the Torah. Okay? These converted Pharisees were still adhering to Jewish law. They were unwilling to see Judaism die out, so they adopted a legalistic idea of salvation. Jesus inaugurated a new era in which the law, as understood by the Jews of this day, would no longer be the guiding principle. principle for the kingdom of God. The reformer Martin Luther has been quoted as saying that Paul's epistle to the Galatians is his most favorite in the whole Bible. He says that in his commentary of the letter that although out of pure grace, God does not impute our sins to us, he nonetheless did not want to do this until complete and ample satisfaction of his law and his righteousness had been made. Now, since this was impossible for us, God ordained for us in our place one who took upon himself all of the punishment we deserve. He fulfilled the law for us. He averted the judgment of God from us and appeased God's wrath. And God, therefore, grace cost us nothing. But it cost another much to get it for us. Grace was purchased with the incalculable infinite treasure, the Son of God himself. It's interesting how the laws of Moses play out even throughout the Old Testament. Moses gave 365 prohibitions and 248 positive commands. 613 laws in all. David reduced them to 11 in Psalm 15. Isaiah, in Isaiah 33, and if you want to look them up, they're verses 14, 15, made them 6. Micah 6, verse 8, binds them into 3 commands. And Habakkuk, in chapter 2, verse 4, reduces them all to one great statement. But the righteousness live by their faith. See, Christ freed us from the requirements of the law by his death and resurrection. Therefore, Christ has become the end of the law for Christians. And it is faith that saves. Faith that saves. And not law. Now, Paul is saying in our lesson this morning, for freedom Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to the yoke of slavery. The yoke of slavery being circumcision and the law. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Freedom means opportunity to choose, the opportunity to make decisions, being able to take responsibility for our actions. But, don't you hate that? But, don't you hate every time somebody says something, they'll give you something, hey, you're doing a great job, but, you really look great, but, you know, I really like that idea. Always a but. Well, Paul throws in a big but. A big one. For it is easy to see how some of the people in the churches to which Paul was writing were misusing their freedom. God forgave us. They said, in effect, okay, all right, let's let it go. We're forgiven. We can do whatever we want. Let's live it up. Let's watch that porn show. Hey, the neighbor's wife. Yeah, she's kind of cute. Let's live it up. So Paul is sensing this, and he says, for you were called to freedom, brothers and sisters, only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence. But through love, become slaves to one another. Do you see that paradox here? A contradiction of sorts? First he says, of course, to set us free, but then he tells us to become slaves. Christian freedom, freedom to serve one another in love. The slavery of love is contrasted to two other kinds of slavery. First, the immediate context puts this command to serve in love in direct contrast with indulging in sinful nature. Our sinful nature causes us to be slaves to our own selfish desires, but love expresses itself in service to the needs of others. Spirit, flesh. Now second, the command to serve in love is contrasted to slavery under the law. Christians are not under the law, enslaved to it, but they are commanded to be under others as slaves to serve them. Christian obligation is not subjection to the law, but subjection to one another and love. These two other kinds of slavery always threaten to rob us of our freedom to serve others in love. If I'm enslaved to my own sinful nature, I will absorb in my selfish interest rather than the needs of others. See, only when we are set free from slavery to the law and slavery to the flesh will we be able to free to serve one another. We've already learned two things about the meaning of love in this letter. First, love was expressed by Christ, giving of himself for us. Second, love is the expression of true faith. Now we learn that love is expressed by serving one another. The entire law is summed up in two commands. I said it earlier. You shall love your God with all your heart, soul, and mind. And you shall love your neighbor as yourself. See, know that our freedom in Christ is not given for selfish indulgence, but through love to help us serve one another. Paul had to remind the Galatians, and perhaps some of us, of this very thing. I like the story about the man who prayed this prayer. So far to today, Lord, I've done all right. I haven't gossiped. I haven't lost my temper. I have been greedy, grumpy, nasty, selfish, or overindulgent. I am very thankful for that. But in a few moments, Lord, I'm going to get out of bed, and from then on, I'm going to yell. So, amen to that. Paul gives us a whole list of the things that flesh desires, and he warns us that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Live by the Spirit, I say, and do not gratify the desires of the flesh. For what the flesh desires is opposed to the Spirit, and what the Spirit desires is opposed to the flesh. For these are opposed to each other, and to prevent you from doing what you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not subject to the law. Now the works of the flesh are obvious. Fornication, impurity, immorality, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, strife, jealousy, anger, quarrels, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and things like all of those. And I'm warning you, as I warned you before, those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But, there's that but. Then Paul says, by contrast, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. These are the marks of a Spirit-filled life. This is what a life lived like Jesus will look like. It will be a life of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. If you are letting the Spirit direct your life, then you are living your life like Jesus. You know, there's a story told about Billy Graham. Billy Graham was driving through a small southern town. He was stopped by a policeman and charged with speeding. Graham admitted his guilt, but was told by the officer that he would have to appear in court. The judge asked, "Guilty or not guilty?" When Graham was guilty, the judge replied, "That'd be $10. $1 for every mile you were over the limit." Suddenly, the judge recognized the famous minister. "You have violated the law," he said. "The fine must be paid, but I am going to pay it for you." He took a $10 bill from his own wallet, attached the ticket, and then took Graham out and bought him a steak dinner. "That," said Billy Graham, "is how God treats repentant sinners." The first in that list of the marks of the Spirit-filled life, the one has given the most emphasis, is love. Love. Love is the focus of the entire ethical appeal. Serve one another in love. Love fulfills the law. Love is the expression of faith. Love is demonstrated in a tangible way in the sacrificial love of Christ. And all other moral qualities in the list define and flow from love. God is love. God is love. Joy is the result of a healthy relationship. When relationships fall apart because of broken commitments, there's a loss of joy. When there's a conflict and bitterness, as there was in the Galatian churches, there is no joy. But the first result of true love in relationships is the renewal of joy. Joy is love rejoicing. Now, peace is also the result of a relationship built by loving service. Instead of hatred or discord, there is harmony and order in relationships. Peace is love trusting. Patience is the opposite of fits of rage or short temper. It is the quality of staying with people even when constantly wronged and irritated by them. And I have to confess that this is a hard one for me at times. Patience is love enduring. Kindness and goodness are joined with patience to teach that a good disposition and doing good toward people is a way to stay with them in love. Kindness is love serving. Faithfulness is the quality of keeping commitments in a relationship. The Galatians had proved to be fickle in their attitude toward Paul. Only the Spirit can produce quality of loyalty, no matter the cost. Faithfulness is love proving. Gentleness. Gentleness is the opposite of selfish ambition. Gentleness is an expression of humility, considering the needs and hurts of others before one's personal goals. Gentleness is love touching. Self-control is the opposite of self-indulgence. Those who are spirit-led will not indulge in sinful nature. They do not use other people to gratify their own sinful appetites. Self-control is love restraining. See, in Paul's ethical appeal, this list of qualities paints a picture of relationships that are built and nourished by the presence of the Spirit. No wonder Paul says, against such things there is no law. The Spirit life is not a life against the law. It is a life that fulfills the law. The way of fulfillment of the law is not to live under the law like slaves, but to live by the Spirit as children of God. Not only do we have the freedom to not do some things out of love, we have the freedom to do some things out of love. We have the those things are things that we otherwise would not do. And that might cost us time, our energies, and even some of our money. Now, I already said, remember the last time that I was here. Love always costs something. Every time you reach out in faith, something will change. Every time you reach out in love, something will also change. And it will change for the glory of God. And whoever is reaching out in love will be rewarded by God in His way and in His time. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Paul reminds us that generosity is the fruit of the Spirit. So let us generously share of the gifts that we have been given. Let us present our offerings to God.